Good afternoon, all of you. And the CSIR Secretary Sikyasa live webinar on Connect with the Scientist series. We have the fourth event on today. Today we have Dr. M. Sadish. Dr. M. Sadish received his PhD in chemistry from Indian Institute of Technology, Madras, in 2006. Then he moved to National Institute for Materials, Japan for the 3 years. After having 3 years of experience as a postdoctoral researcher, he moved to Tohoku University, Sendai, Japan as a JSPS research fellow for 2 years. From April 2012 onwards, he joined in CSIR Sikri Karakudi as a scientist in functional materials division. This research interest is mainly focused on the development of advanced materials for energy conversion and storage. He has published more than 125 research articles in reputed internal journals, highly with impact factors, 4 JAKs, 2 chemical materials, 3 ACS applied materials and interfaces, and chemical communications. He has 6 book chapters, and more than 150 conference presentations and 2 patents to his credit. He has a Hatch index of 34 and total citation of nearly 5,000 as of last year. With this brief introduction, now I invite Dr. M. Sadish for his presentation. Sir, please.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for the nice introduction. I take this opportunity to thank Director CSIR Sikri and CSIR, particularly Jikyasa and Dr. Angappan, sir, for giving this opportunity to share some of my research experience with the youngsters, particularly KV students and other school students. So I'm sure that really it will help them to understand a little bit about nanomaterials and why we need electrochemical energy storage devices. So with this, I start my presentation. I hope you can able to see my presentation, right? If someone has any issues, please let me know.
It's very nice.
Okay.
Very nice.
Yeah. Okay, so with this I start here. So that today what I'm going to talk is about nanomaterials, particularly the applications of nanomaterials in electrochemical energy storage devices. I keep this presentation is very fundamental so that the students can easily understand, and then they can put their imagination here. So I'm sure that at the end of the talk, you may be familiar with nanomaterials and what are the applications for these nanomaterials, particularly in electrochemical energy storage devices, and also the applications of nanomaterial in other areas. So with this, let us start with nanomaterials. So many of you are aware, since these nanomaterials are new, not new for us. It is known for a long time, but unfortunately last 2 or 3 decades only there are emerging applications comes from these nanomaterials. There are several reasons why these nanomaterials were ignored for so many years, because though we have nanomaterials, we doesn't have any tool to prove their properties, as well as to confirm their properties or how to make them in nano size. So this knowledge was not there for maybe I can say maybe 20, 30 years before. Though unknowingly we are made some kind of nanoparticles and then we used it for several applications. I will let you know in the coming slides. So what are they, nanomaterials? So in size, if you see it, there will be in 10 power minus 9. Okay, so in the sense, 1 billionth of in the size. Or if the materials, if you can take the size with between the range of 0.1 nanometer to 100 nanometer, they're generally called as nanomaterials. Here there are some confusion. People will even talk about 500 nanometer size particle also nanomaterials. Here, the definition of nanomaterials is applicable only for 0.1 nanometer to under nanometer or even less than 0.1 nanometer. Because when you have the more and more size, the properties are changing. So some nanoparticles, they may not have any significant change in their property even if you bring them into up to 50 nanometer in size. In such a case, we have to call them, we cannot call them as a nanoparticle though the size of the particles is within this range what I mentioned. Okay. So here it can be the nanoparticle can be like any metals or ceramics or polymeric materials or composites also available. One nanometer is equivalent to almost 3 to 5 atoms if you put it in a line or in a row, then this will be close to 1 nanometer. For example, for your imagination, that human hair is 5 orders magnitude larger than the nanomaterials. You can understand human hair, we can see in our naked eyes, you could see there will be very, very fine wires, right? So when you compare nanoparticles, there is
Yes. What do you want?
Why are they interested in, people are interested in nanomaterials, okay? So when you go for nanomaterials, we are expecting some kind of change in the property or behavior, okay? Then only, as I told you earlier, we should have some kind of property changes. Then only we can call it them as nanoparticles. Otherwise, just reducing the size of the particle does not give you any advantage. So we are expecting some kind of behavior in electrons in their transport, or the correlation of optoelectronic devices or the conventional bulk material and compared to bulk materials. If you take electron in semiconductors, which is easy to control and accessible, but it is the inherent property of the electrons, we cannot change it. Okay. Whereas if you take the electrons in atomic system, we can have control on inherent performance. But you cannot easily, it is not easily controllable and accessible. So there is a difficulty. So in the case, if you take a semiconductor quantum dot material, the advantage of both semiconductor and atomic system can be combined. I'll tell you what is this quantum dots, all these things. Okay, so this is a small illustration where you could see you can compare your baseball with some water molecule, okay? The baseball which you are talking about is in the size of this much. You know, I can say the 3 is 10 power 8 times, okay? Whereas the water molecule is 0.1 nanometer. One single water molecule. I am sure that water molecule is H2O. So you have one oxygen atom, two hydrogen atoms. So all these three atoms, generally the total size will be around 0.1 nanometer. Here, actually, each molecule or particle is made up of several particles or several atoms or ions, right? So, for example, this is my, I take one single atom or ion. If I can, so it is a highly reactive in nature, okay? So you want to have this kind of assembly, when you find some the similar materials. You can easily understand when you go to school, maybe you, from your street, you may be the only one person, right? After going, the moment you enter the gate, you can find your friends and then you will get assembled with them. Similarly, when you grow up, then the number of friends also is growing, right? Similarly, this is what is happening when the individual atom when it is fined with similar atoms, then it is form a kind of molecule. So obviously the size of the particle is increases. So some particles is keep on growing, some particle will restrict their growth after certain near size. So it depends on what way you are preparing the materials. Okay, so now the important point is here, for example, this there are 13 atoms here, there are 55 atoms here, that's why I mentioned M55. So here I put 147 atoms and then here I put 309 atoms. Okay, I just arranged it in very compact manner as much as possible according to me. So now, why this, you can ask me a question, why one single particle is there, there is a different property. When you have a few particles assembled, there is a different property. When there are so many particles are assembled, you can have a different properties. Okay, so that is a major question. So that that could be addressed by the surface area and the number of surface atoms. For example, if a person, you assume that you are sitting alone in your, maybe in a chair or maybe a computer table or somewhere, okay? So both your arms are free. Okay, you can freely, you can expand or you can rotate or whatever you want, you can do it. Whereas the moment if you go to the theater or some show, then there will be an extra seat, then you have to share one hand with the other person. So that said, that means the people sitting in the row, the only the person sitting on the edges can freely rotate one hand. The person sitting inside, both the hands are arrested. Okay, he cannot simply rotate his hands. Okay, exactly when you put one seat behind or one seat in front of you, then obviously in your movement in all these directions have been arrested. So exactly it's the same thing when you have a single particle. This particle is in free in move in all three directions, x and y, z axis. Whereas when the moment when you put these particles together, for example, if I put 13 atoms around this, basically this particle will be inside. The 13 similar particles are get assembled. That means this particle is not even exposed to the atmosphere. It's completely covered. When I put 55 atoms, still there are so many particles comes closer, then this most of these atoms are, even this 13 atoms are hided. When you come to 309 particles, the number of particles exposed in the to the atmosphere or the reaction environment is something different from the number of particles inside. So that's why this properties also changes. Here I put the first cell with the 13 number of atoms. In such a case, I can see that 92% of atoms are exposed to the atmosphere. Whereas when I go to the 55 atom cell, then only 76% of the atoms are exposed. So similarly, when I increase in the cell thickness with the number of particles or number of atoms or ions, then you see, for example, if I have 1415 particles, only 35% of the atoms are exposed to the atmosphere. I mean, here the percentage of atoms, not 35 atoms, okay? You should not get confused. Out of 1415 atoms, only 35% of atoms are exposed to the atmosphere. So that's why the properties also changes. Here, one good example is here, for example, these cases, I can reduce the size, particle size, maybe I start with 11 nanometer to 1 nanometer. I am just checking the melting point of this particular atom. You see here, when the particle size, that I mean the size is 10 nanometer in size or 9 nanometer in size or 8 nanometer in size, there was no much changes in this melting point. There may be hardly maybe 10 degree Celsius or 20 degree Celsius variation takes place. When the moment I come to 3 to 1, you could see this melting point is changing drastically. For example, here it may be around 450. When I have maybe 10 atoms, it's very close to 900. That means the melting point is reduced to half just by changing few atoms. When I change 10 to 9, there was not much change. But when I change this 4 to 1, there is a great change in the melting point. So that means only this area is playing a major role in for this particular atom, for particular property. Here I'm just worried about only the melting point of the atoms. So how the number, the other one is the surface area is increases. So you can just simply visualize, for example, you can take a 4 cm cube. Okay, so if overall surface area of this cube is like 4 × 4 × there are 6 faces, so you can get 96 cm² for this overall cube. Now I am doing this cube, I am cutting this cube in all three directions. I am cutting in middle of here and this axis and this axis. In x-axis, y-axis, z-axis. So obviously I end up with 8 small cubes. Each cube is of size of 2 cm. Okay, so now there are 8 cubes. So each cubes are 2 cm in its in the A value. If you see the surface area, 2 × 2 × there are 6, so 24 cm². There are 8 cubes, so totally you can get.
Hello, Mr. Satish.
Yes, Karthik. Hello. Hello. Please tell me. Hello. Hello. Sir, you can proceed, sir.
Okay. Is it okay? Right. Its slides are moving, right?
Yeah, moving.
Okay, you can follow me, right? Yeah, if you could not follow, please let me know. So here there are 8 cubes, so that each cube is 20 cm² in surface area. There are those, so obviously you're getting 192 cm² for example this. And here I did not make much change, I the same particle only, I cut it into several pieces, that's what I have done. But obviously there are more surface area is increased. So similarly, instead of in centimeter, I can go for a millimeter or nanometer size cutting by having some kind of tools, so that I can each cube maybe some 1 nm or less than 1 nm, then I can have a more number of cubes here. Obviously the surface area will be like anything. In this case, I can get more than 1000 or 3000 cm² or nanometers in square. Okay. So the same thing we are doing with one of the best known material for the graphite. And graphite, I'm sure that all of you are using it when you write use a pencil for writing your drawing your graph. You are already exfoliating few layers of graphene. Okay, so graphite is nothing but layer of carbon atoms. So if you take, that means you can assume you can buy one bundle of paper. And then remove the cover, there may be some 500 sheets or 100 sheets minimum, right? So if you see, there is no bonding between the two sheets, but you can keep it in very calm on your table. The moment if you put all the papers in the air, then you could see it will cover entire area of your room. Okay, that means more surface area comes out. So similarly, when you are having a graphite of 100 layers or 1000 layers, when you write it on paper or draw some image on paper, hardly few layers are coming out. That is nothing but the exfoliation. So that's what we are doing it, but though we have done this process, we never know that was the exfoliation process. Okay, so after this invention only now we realizing that, okay, we also already made our graphene when we are in childhood, right? So this can be done by so many ways, since there was no bonding between these two sheets. I'm sure that you might be studied some chemical bonding in your 8th standard or 9th standard. And then in addition to this, there will be weak force of attraction that is generally called as van der Waals force of attraction. The main advantage of van der Waals force of attraction is there was no sharing of electron or any formation of bonding between the atoms. So only some kind of physical attraction or kind of chemical attraction. So this case, this case of graphite to graphene, the graphene part layers are simply arranged as like your paper which you are using for your day-to-day life. So when coming to metals, what is happening when you change the size from bulk material to nano-size material? Okay, if I take bulk size material, I'm sure you might be studied there once, there was no gap between your valence band and conduction band. Okay, so that's why it is highly conductive in nature. Okay, or I can say the valence band and conduction bands are getting overlapped a lot, so that the movement of electrons are easy in the case of metal, whereas in the semiconductor that will be a different. There is a gap. Insulator, the gap is very high, right? So when I take a metal, I reduce the particle size, maybe from the bulk material to some few nanometer in size. I am just creating some kind of band gap between the valence band and conduction band. So originally my metal is conductive, now it will become a semiconductor. Okay, so not only that, when I have a band, I can also change, when I able to change the band, the gap between these two, I can also change the color of the metal. For example, if the gap is small, so that I put some small light energy, visible light, so that it will absorb some particular wavelength according to the band gap. So then it will be on color. The same material I reduced in a few atoms in size, so that the band gap is increases, so that it will absorb different wavelength. Obviously, it will give you a different color. So the same metal, I change in the only the size I'm changing it. Obviously, I can tune the color of the metal. I'm sure that many of you have seen your gold, right? The day-to-day life we are using each day. Gold is in yellow in color, right? But have you ever seen a gold in blue color or red color? If you go and show somebody that it's our, this is a gold that I made it in red color, nobody will buy it from you, right? But here I can do it. I can buy this is, that's what I told you. This is the glass which is made in 4th century. So they have gold and silver nanoparticles. When they shine light, it will give you in different colors. Depending on the wavelength of the light, then it will give you a different color to the glass cup. But at the time, we never know that there is a nanoparticle. The color changes occurs because of these nanoparticles. Okay? So this is what I was telling you. I can change from a colorless to a very colorful metal by changing the size of the particle. Okay? Since I'm changing the gold nanoparticle from maybe less than 2 nanometer, almost no color. If I have a 5 nanometer, 6 nanometer, 12 nanometer, up to 90 nanometer, you could see how can I can change the color of the gold. This can be done because of this. Earlier slide, we have seen that there is a band gap change, right? So this is taking place. That's why this color is also getting changed. So this is what the laboratory experiments we can do it. If you have the facility of maybe giving some kind of gold chloride, and then you can initially it will be a colorless precipitate, and when this nanoparticle get assembled for like few particles get assembled, it will give you one color, and more particles get assembled, the color will changes to some other color. It's not only a metal, we can also do it with some kind of semiconductor like a cadmium sulfide or cadmium selenide, where the size of the particles are ultra low in size, then obviously the color also is getting changes. Okay, so the same concept has been used in the 4th century or 5th century in the case of this tome in the search in the cathedral of France. So they are using different kind of oxides, for example gold chloride in uranium oxides. So this the color of the dome can be easily changed. Okay, so they without knowing that they are making some nanoparticle, they have done this experiment, this applications in long before. So here again the same thing, to convenience you, I have put some different size and then different color for this semiconductors, and then this cadmium selenide, you can change very beautiful colors by changing the size of the nanoparticle from 2 nanometer to 8 nanometer, I can have 3 different or 4 different colors. Okay, so basically the band gap of the semiconductor, actually in the case of metal is a band, there is no band gap. When you reduce the size, it will become there is some gap is created. Whereas when in the case of semiconductor, already there is a band gap. When you reduce the particle size, you are increasing the band gap. After a certain time, you can have a discrete energy levels, as like your molecular orbital or atomic orbitals. then you can have a discrete energy levels because of this color tuning is highly possible. So coming back to the graphene, since I'm sure that many of you are aware what is now nanoparticle, how it can be used. In the case of graphene, I'm going to show you some of the applications for electrochemical energy storage devices. So here, as I told you earlier, this is like a 3D arrangement of graphene sheets. So if you have several layers, several hundreds of layers, then it is called as a graphite. If you just take one top sheet, so it is called graphene. So the same tube, same sheet, if you roll it like this, and then if you end up with like this, then you can call them as a carbon nano tubes. Or if you make it like a football out of this graphene sheet, then you can call them as a fullerenes, C60. It looks like a football. Okay, so generally this is a zero dimensional material. We call it as this is a one dimensional material. This is a three dimensional materials. And then the two dimensional material was missing for a long time. Very recently it was invented by this Navosulva and then Andrew Jim in physics 2000. They have made a Nobel Prize for the invention of this graphene sheet. So not only so proved the performance of these nano sheets or this graphene sheets has several remarkable properties like high Young models and high fracture strength, and the mobility of charge carriers is really high, and thermal conductivity is also high. The surface area is very, very high, to 2600 meter square per gram, not centimeter square, it's a meter square per gram. Okay. So that much amount of applications are available for this kind of graphene sheets. So it finds there are a lot of applications. Here there is applications of nanomaterial in various fields, not necessarily only a carbon, it can be a polymers or structural materials or in consumer goods, and then it can also be used for energy or electronics applications, environmental remediation or biomedical applications. There are so many applications for this. I just go through few of these very quickly, and then since many of them we have already seen or we have realized, the nanotechnology makes smaller transistor or smaller memory or smaller circuitry. So as you know that this is a kind of transistor you can see. So now this kind of transistor could be made to very small amount. It's maybe 100 nanometer or 200 nanometer, or worst case it's maybe 1 micron in size. Okay, so this is a human brain can build almost 100 billion neurons. Okay, so coming to the memory thing, you could see this. I'm sure that this is a 2 gigabytes hard drive which we are using for a long time. Okay, in 1970s, whereas now you can see this is a small pen drive 2 GB. Now even this is a very bigger for 2 GB. Now with this size I can have more than 128 GB. Okay, so here you could see there is a small head, that like a nail head, so that in the head disk can able to store 1000 GB memory in this small area. So this area is developing a very large. I'm sure you maybe come across these images. So this is a originally computer, it's the first in made in 18th century, where you could see this Altisia. It will occupy some several rooms for to accommodate this computer. But I'm sure that now this is not even bigger in size. Even there is very small in size. Even my mobile phone is much better than what is I have in my desktop computer. The same thing, there is a drastic change in the electronic display. You could see this LEDs, DVs and high density displays are in the market. You can see originally it was maybe started with 17 inches or 20 inches. Now it can go up to 100 inches also, or more than that. Or you can also put several displays together. You can make a very large screen. Okay, out of that. So all because of this development in the nanomaterials. It's not only in the in the electronics, it's also in the healthcare. There are a lot of improvements. You can even put some kind of dye molecule. You can see the movement of dye molecule in your body. So where it get clotted or where it get accumulated, all this information could be done very easily by having without having any cutting and stretching on your body. Okay, so that much can be done by simply having some kind of nanoparticles. When coming to the energy storage systems, there are two major system. One is a batteries, other one is a supercapacitors. And more important, these two stores electrical energy, whereas the hydrogen energy is also one of the energy storage medium where your hydrogen gas is used as a fuel. As like your LPG gas or CNC gas, your hydrogen also can be used. So that's why people are making hydrogen production by splitting water. Water can be split into hydrogen and oxygen. Okay, how to make a very pure hydrogen is the $1 million question, and then people are working on it, how to make very cheaper and effective hydrogen production. That will be definitely a future fuel for all of us. And coming to batteries and supercapacitors, though we have a different kind of energy conversion medium like kind of solar cells or your windmills or some electricity production by hydropower, all these things, we have to store this energy for our remote use. For example, if you have some solar panels, you can produce electricity. But unfortunately, that electricity, you cannot use it in the night time unless otherwise you store it in some medium. Okay. The similarly, the windmills. Okay, the wind is very heavy, you can produce a huge amount of electricity. But when there was no wind, still you need some electricity for your routine life, right? So that time that excess energy, electricity has to be stored in some devices. So that's why your batteries or supercapacitors plays a major role. Not only that, there are electric vehicles also coming into the market, or even your electronic applications like your mobile phone or laptop or portable, particularly portable electronics, definitely need some kind of energy storage medium. So in batteries, I'm sure you might be read, there are two different kind of batteries. One is a primary batteries. We call it as a disposable. Okay, once after use it, you simply will dispose it. Whereas in the case of secondary batteries, you can recharge and use it for several times. So that's why we call it them as a secondary batteries or rechargeable batteries. There are different kind of rechargeable batteries. Why there are different kind based on the applications, we can go for different kind of batteries. I don't want to go much detail about it, but so I'll just give you one or two examples. Okay, whereas the lead acid batteries, we mainly use it for our household applications, particularly UPS or your car batteries or your bike batteries is mainly lead acid batteries, because the energy density is relatively higher, and then you can use it for several times of charge discharge, and then it may be cheaper. Okay, so all these things. Whereas if you coming to some applications like your toys and all these things, so you use nickel zinc batteries or nickel cadmium batteries. Okay, whereas when you come for your mobile phone or laptop application, generally people are using a lithium ion battery, since you have a really high energy, both the volumetric energy and then gravimetric energy. So the volumetric energy density or gravimetric energy density is nothing but how much amount of energy I can store within 1 kilogram of weight, or how much this is called a gravimetric energy density. So here, the how much amount of energy I can store in the given area, or 1 liter or 2 liters, okay. So that here the volume of the device is more important. Here the weight of the device is more important. Here we are optimizing the energy with respect to the weight. Here we are optimizing the energy with respect to the volume. So if you optimize like this, this is a volumetric energy density. If you do it like this way, weight, then it's a gravimetric energy density. Unfortunately, most of the applications, we need high energy in small area, at the same time in with small weight. We don't want to carry for very long or very heavy weight, or at the same time in very large size device, we cannot take it, right? So that's why in most of the portable application, we are using lithium ion batteries. In the case of secondary batteries, there are different kind of batteries. I'm just quickly just give you some idea. There are zinc carbon batteries. So used in SAS in all inexpensive AA and C and D dry cell batteries. Okay. The alkaline batteries are used in common Duracells or energy size batteries. Okay. The electrodes are zinc and manganese oxide. And then this is there is alkaline electrolyte. You can have some lead acid batteries used in cars and electronics devices. Okay. This is a rechargeable and then there is a memory effect. Here in the case of no memory effect. The memory effect is nothing but, for example, in some cases when I use a battery, I charge it to 100% and then use 50% only, then I will charge it again. If I do the similar process without discharging to 20% or 10%, some of these batteries will assume that only 50% is its original capacity. So the next time when you discharge more than 50%, you cannot do it. So coming to the lithium ion batteries, I'm sure the lithium is, you could see this is a third in your periodic table. The weight of the lithium is almost 7 grams. And then there's so, this, like sodium or potassium, this is an alkali metal and it's highly reactive. So as like sodium, you cannot have it in lithium metal in air or in aqueous medium. You need some non-aqueous medium and then you have to protect the lithium ions, lithium metal to expose into the air. Okay. So lithium ion is batteries is developed in 1970s. The originally they have used lithium metal and then later because of safety issues, they change it to lithium cobalt oxide and graphite. I will explain you how these lithium ion batteries are working. So mainly it is in 1991, it's mainly introduced as a commercial product by Sony Corporation. So this is a look of lithium ion batteries. I'm sure you might be come across these devices. Each cases, this is a small mobile phones we use. So here, this is a laptop batteries. Here we use some cameras, we use this. We have, maybe I'll just show you this slide first and then maybe I'll come back to that slide. Here, in the lithium ion, hello. Can I continue?
Sir, you can continue, sir.
Yeah. So, in the case of lithium ion battery, I'll just explain you how it works so that then easy for you to understand why, what are the problems and what are the things can be improved for lithium ion batteries. Also, how these nanomaterials plays a major role in these lithium ion batteries. So, any batteries, if you take, you may have two terminals. One is your negative terminal, nothing but anode. The other one is a positive. We call it as a cathode. Okay. So originally you have your lithium containing compound here. Here your carbon, that's nothing but graphite. I can use it here. So when I charge it, this device, initially when I connect it to the external power, I will give some electricity. So what I'm doing is I'm forcefully moving some electrons through external circuit from here to here. So from cathode to anode. Okay. So that's what I'm doing when I charging my batteries. For example, I remove one electron from here, one lithium will become lithium plus. Since it lose one electron, so the, since electron comes through the external circuit, so it will become Li plus. So the green color dot you can understand. So this green color dot will move through the electrolyte from one side to the positive terminal to the negative terminal through the electrolyte. So this anode and cathode are separated by a electrolyte, also a separator. The separator is nothing but to avoid physical contact between your anode and the cathode. So if you touch the anode and cathode, there is nothing, your reaction will not happen. So that's why you should have some non-conductive medium as a separator. At the same time, you should have some kind of electrolyte to this lithium ion move through this electrolyte from one side to the other side. Now the electron goes through the external circuit. It comes to this carbon cloud. Now this lithium will become lithium plus. So and then it will move towards this direction. So when it's lithium plus comes to the electrolyte is get coordinated by this lithium ion. Okay, so then along with this, it will move from this side. I told you there is a gap between the two seats. Okay, so this gap is called Van der Waals gap. The attraction between the two seats is a Van der Waals force of attraction. So the gap between the two seats is around 0.3 nanometer. Okay, so exactly if you see 0.33 nanometer in size, the gap between the two seats. So the lithium ion is much smaller than that gap. So obviously it will come and get intercalated in between the graphene sheets. So when the lithium ion comes and get intercalated, so when get binded, we call them as a intercalation process. Okay, so this is happening during charging. Once I remove all the lithium ion from here to here, so that means I made my battery 100% charged. Okay, now I discharge my batteries by connecting some mobile phone or torch light or anything. Okay, and if you give some load, then this electron instantaneously come from anode to cathode side via the external circuit. So when it is coming from this side to this side, it will do the job. Okay, so once this electron comes back here, similarly this lithium again has to come back as like it's originally, it will come from here, so it has to come back like this way. So this is again, when you come out from this, this process is called deintercalation. So when it goes in, it's intercalation. When it comes out, this is a deintercalation. So this, once it is comes here and it goes to the crystal, then it become to original stage. Then I have all, for all the lithium ions comes, then obviously my discharge is zero. That means there was no power in my battery. If I want to use again, I have to connect this battery to the external circuit and move electron from here to here. So that's what we are doing every day. Okay. So this, how much amount of lithium ion can get intercalated by this material is given by the capacity of the batteries. Okay. For example, if I use graphite, I can accommodate several lithium ions. For example, if 1 gram of graphite I take, I can store 372 milliampere hour. I'm sure that when you buy a battery, you can see the backside. What is the specification of your batteries? So maybe 1000 milliampere hour or 4000 milliampere hour. Now you could see that even my mobile phone can store 5000 milliampere hour capacity. Okay. So here, I'm, as I told you here, we are optimizing to the weight of the material. So this is what it is working, your batteries. Now when you see this working principle, it looks very good. There are no issues when I have this batteries, right? So in such a case, it has to do this job maybe n number of cycles. Then the sense, if I buy a battery, it should come for me throughout my life. Okay, unless otherwise I physically damage these batteries, it has to serve for me forever, right? But that is not happening in our day-to-day life. There were a lot of issues. Also, why this battery get fails? I will give you some idea about that. And why the batteries are very complicated or very expensive? Because of the materials which we are using it. Though we are using inexpensive graphite as an anode, the cathode material has a lot of complications. Okay. So all the materials cannot be used as anode or cathodes. There should be some selection criteria. I will tell you what are the criteria for selecting a material. Since in the lithium ion batteries, we are not using any metallic lithium here. You see this entire picture, I never used any metallic lithium. Okay, I took some metal lithium containing compound. So why they are not using lithium, metallic lithium, is the safety. Okay. Now I go back here. I just explain you. I just made it in very simple way. Though one side I'm using a graphite, the other side using a graphite lithium containing compound. Then only the lithium will be in this compound can settle from anode to cathode or cathode to anode. So though I have so many compounds, I can use only lithium containing compound in my lithium ion battery as a cathode material. Now, still there are a lot of lithium containing compounds. but the compound has to be highly crystalline in nature. I'm sure you all of you aware that what is a crystallinity. Crystallinity is nothing but I can say in very crude manner, I can say this sitting place of this atoms or the ions are fixed. For example, here, so these red color atoms or the brown color atoms are correspond to cobalt. These white color atoms are correspond to oxygen. So this dark atoms are correspond to lithium. Okay, so the lithium ions or cobalt ions or oxide ions are arranged in such a manner so that it gets a crystalline structure. So though I have so many compounds, I should have only lithium containing compounds. Even the lithium containing compound, I should have some compounds which is in crystalline in nature. Not only that, when I charging it, I am removing the lithium. So for example, if I assume that there are 100 lithiums in this crystal system, if I remove all the 100 lithium, that means all these places become empty. Okay. So once if I remove all these lithium ions, so this structure should not get collapsed. Okay, since nothing but this is a build up, you can assume this is a kind of building. If I removing some of the bricks from here, so this some many cases what will happen, this will completely collapse. So that should not happen. Even I remove all the lithium ions, the structure has to be stable. Then only when I discharge this lithium ion will come back and goes and sit its original position. So these are the some of the selection criteria. Not only that, I'm just putting in a very crude manner. So for example, if I have 100 lithium ions, I move to from anode to cathode. Now I am discharging it from this side to this side. All this 100 lithium ion has to come. In what will happen is in the reality, so it will find some electronically or electrically, energetically very strong bonding between some of the functional groups present in the graphene sheet or some of the defect in the crystal. So what will happen is some of the ions will strongly stick on here. It will not come back. So only 98 or 96 will come here. Even out of this 98 or 96, it will not go and occupy its original position. Some of them will occupy in some other vacant interstitial position or some voids in the crystal system. So next time when you are settling, maybe only I have maybe 90 or 95 atoms. So this loss of lithium ions is happening in each cycle. So that's why when you buy a brand new battery, it will work for you for more than 2 days. If I buy a 400 milliampere hour batteries containing a mobile phone, if I can charge 100%, I can use for 2 days. Okay, or if I play a game, continuously I'm using it, still 1 day it will serve for me. Whereas at the same time, when after a year, you see the same batteries, even though I charge it for 100%, I can see half day my charge will go down. Because the number of lithium ions settling between anode and cathode goes down. In addition to this, there are other complicated processes also happening. Okay, I don't want to go into detail of these, since that is once you become expert or you become pioneer in this area, then this inner details are required. Right now you can see the number of ions settling between anode and cathodes are become less. So that's why after a certain 1 year or 2 years, maybe hardly 10 lithium ions will be settling your anode and cathode. Obviously, though your battery source 100% charged, it will not give you for even not even for 1 hour serve. Okay. So that is what the life cycle of your lithium ion batteries are going down. So that's why you have to replace your mobile phone or your laptop or at least your laptop batteries every 3 years or 4 years. So there are a lot of opportunities in this area. When I have nanomaterials there are so many issues like stored energy per mass. That means, as I told you earlier, that mobile phones are very heavy for having 100 milliampere charge. Now I can, for the same weight, I can have 5000 milliampere hour. 5 times I can increase the energy density. Energy density in the sense per kilogram of material or gram of material. I'm normalizing with the weight of the material. or volume of the material, or that also I can do it. The power is also important factor. Okay, so power is there are two parameters. One is the power density and energy density. I will explain you in the coming slide what is power density and energy density, and the recharge time. So many of you are not interested to have charging your batteries for 5 hours or 6 hours. Now there are some quick charging process also comes. If you go for that option, then obviously you have to pay more. And then lifetime, it's already we are aware of it. And more importantly, the cost has to be reduced. And safety. In many cases, the lithium-ion batteries are not safe, and there are some accidents also happened. If you try to abuse the batteries, there then there may be adverse effect will take place. So the safety is a questionable. And more importantly, the environmental sustainability of the material has to be very high. So most of the time, it is not advisable to throw the your batteries, either it's lithium-ion batteries or metal hydride batteries or lead-acid batteries. It's not advisable to just throw in the atmosphere. There is a mechanism to dispose the batteries, unless otherwise it will make some adverse effect to the environment. So there are a lot of opportunities in this area, particularly for the youngsters to think about the power and energy or the lifetime or cost or safety of this. So here these are the various opportunities for the materials. As I told you earlier, here what we generally select material is, which is this is a potential. So basically you have to select two materials. One is from the top end, the other one is the bottom end. Okay, the difference between these two values of this material is the voltage of the particular battery. Okay, obviously if you have a very high voltage of one side, very low voltage for the other side, then the battery voltage will be very high. When the voltage is very high, you can go for several applications. Okay, for most of the cases, we need a 12 volt or 48 volt or 230 volt, right? So if you want to have such kind of voltage, then if you single device has to be has more voltage. For example, if I select some material somewhere near one, for example, this tin based materials, if I may take the another material like a manganese based material, this is 3, this is 1.5, then the difference is only 1.5. So that means my battery voltage will be only 1.5 I can go. Whereas I take some lithium manganese containing metal oxide here around 4.1 or 4.2, I take the graphite is here is around close to 0.2, then the voltage of my battery is 4 volt. For 12 volt batteries, I have to simply connect three batteries in series. So 4 × 3, obviously I get 12 volt. Whereas here, if I have to take these electrodes, so the battery voltage is only 1.5. So for the 12 volt, I have to collect more than 6 or 7. Okay, so that's what exactly how this voltage is plays a major role in your batteries. So now I will move into the capacitors or super capacitors. Maybe I will with explaining you the difference between the batteries and the capacitors. Maybe I will just stop my presentation and then I give you some time for you to ask some questions. So you can ask me a question, why the capacitors? Capacitors, I am sure that you might be seen in some of the electronic circuits. If you see, you take your motherboard of some electronic device, you could see there will be some micro capacitors. So generally that will be 1 micron or 10 micron or 50 micron micro farad capacitors. Whereas the super capacitors has 10 power 2 or 10 power 3 farad. That means 10 power 8 to 9 times increment in the energy. So that's why we call them as a super capacitors. So super capacitors and batteries both stores electrical energy. Then you should ask me why we need different kind of devices. Okay. So the difference can be understood by having this kind of profile, where I put energy density and power density here. The power density is very high in the case of capacitors, and super capacitors is also very high. Whereas the energy density of the batteries are very high when compared to capacitors, but the power density of batteries are very low when compared to conventional capacitors. Here the energy density means how much amount of energy I can store in my battery. For example, if I have 1 kilogram of battery, how much amount of energy I can store? That is so by the energy density. Power density in the sense, how much time I require to charge my batteries, or how fast I can take the energy, all the energy stored in my batteries. For example, many of you maybe have seen when you coming to a school, your mother trying to make some kind of chutney by using mixie. So when there was no power, she cannot use your inverter. Okay. But whereas if you see, you can use 4 or 5 electric fans or 2-3 tube lights from morning to evening, even though there was no power in your home. That means you cannot, though your batteries have more energy to run your mixie or grinder for 10 minutes or 20 minutes, the rate of taking the energy from batteries is limited. So that's why if you try to do your mixie, or even if you put your iron box on your lead acid battery based inverter which you have, then everything will shut down. So that the rate of taking the energy from the batteries is limited. Whereas super capacitors, you can add as much energy as possible in a fraction of a second. At the same time, you can take huge amount of energy instantaneously from your super capacitor. But unfortunately, the energy density of the amount of energy stored in your supercapacitors is very small.
Yes,
sir. In the sense, for example, if I have an electric car with run with batteries, okay. So I can go, if I charge my batteries, I can go 400 kilometers, but I can go only 20 kilometers per hour speed. If I want to go for 50 kilometers hour per kilometer per hour speed or 100 kilometers per hour speed, I have to drain more energy from my batteries. That cannot be done. Whereas in the case of supercapacitors, I can go even 200 kilometers per hour speed. Okay, but I can go only 4 or 5 kilometers. After 4 or 5 kilometers, again I have to charge my device. Even if I charge, but here the charging time I need only a 30 seconds or less than a minute. Whereas in your batteries, I'm sure that you may be aware, if you use lead acid batteries, at least 6 to 7 hours you need for complete charging. So these are the issues with the batteries and the supercapacitors. If I want to make a car out of electric, these devices, I should have some kind of hybrid, so that I can go to up to 400 kilometers if I charge my device. At the same time, I need maybe 80 to 100 kilometers hour per speed. Speed is required. Such kind of things is possible by combining this kind of hybrid device. That's why people who are working in capacitors or supercapacitors, they are trying to increase the energy density of the device. Those who are working in batteries, they are trying to increase the power density of the device. So that's why these two devices are required. Of course, each device has its own applications. So wherever huge power is required, for example, the regenerative braking system in the car, whenever you apply a brake, electricity is produced. That electricity cannot be immediately stored in your batteries, since your batteries slowly accept electricity. Okay. Whereas when you apply a brake, you will apply in a fraction of a second, right? So that time huge amount of electricity will be produced. So that could be stored in your supercapacitors, and slowly this energy can be stored into the batteries. Since a supercapacitor cannot store huge amount of energy, maybe if you apply a brake 2-3 times, your supercapacitor will completely get 100% charge. So in such a case, this has to be put it into the battery slowly. So that is what the research is going on. And then this kind of carbon-based materials are used for this kind of supercapacitors as well as battery application. So these are some of the applications of supercapacitors. In the case of race cars, the conventional engine to take maybe 2 or 3 minutes to reach maximum speed. Okay, that means that engine will go slowly only to top speed, but initially 2-3 minutes will be supplied by the supercapacitors. Similarly, this bus is run with the supercapacitors. There is a charging panel. So when the bus goes and stop in the bus stop, the passengers will come down and then new passengers will go in. That time is sufficient for charging this bus. So that bus is again can travel for another 6 or 7 kilometers. So these buses are not good for highway application, but in city applications or transportation within cities, these buses are very excellent. In CSIR Sikri, what we are doing is we are making, I just show you some of these applications. We are making such kind of batteries as well as supercapacitors. So by having different carbon materials fabrication on this for supercapacitor application. I'm sure why carbon materials you may be aware. Since the carbon is has very high melting point and highly conductive in nature. And then there are different kind of carbons, fullerenes, tubes, and carbon nanotubes, carbon nanocones, carbon black. So foams, everything is available. So what we are doing is now we are making some kind of graphene-based materials. Since it has very high surface area, at the same time it's highly conductive in nature, it will be excellent material for batteries as well as a supercapacitor application. How to make the graphene in large quantity, that is a open challenge. So if you find out a method for making a good quality of graphene from graphite in large scale, then definitely that will make a great impact on the R&Ds in not only in the electrochemical energy storage, in many applications the graphene can be used. So here these are the challenges. It means how to achieve the mono dispersity and size and shape and reproducibility and scale up, or building some kind of complex nanostructures. So these are the various challenges in the case of graphene. As I told you earlier, the gap between the two sheets is 0.335 nanometer, but unfortunately the force of attraction is very high. So because of this, even though you can remove it, it will easily go back and get back like this. So to avoid this, people are putting some kind of some bulky molecules in between so that the restacking of the graphene can be avoided. So maybe with this, I just stop it. Maybe if you have any questions, maybe I'm happy to answer. So how to use this kind of graphene for energy storage applications.
Thank you, Dr. M. Shadis. It's a really eye-opening to the younger mind for the electrochemical energy storage. A few of questions from the registered participants. I can ask the questions and please answer. After that, we have to, for the board, we have some of their raising their hands, they will ask the questions. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah, from the Shreya Ghosh from the 12th standard, is a Chalua. What is the procedure of transforming chemical energy to electrical energy in the case of nanomaterials?
Chemical into
electrical energy. What is the procedure for transforming in the case of nanomaterials is used?
No, that's why, as I told you earlier, in the case of batteries, what we are doing is the electrical energy is converted into a chemical energy and it's stored in the form of chemicals. Okay, when you want to electricity back, the chemicals are allowed to react it and then it will give you back the electricity. Okay, so that is what your lead acid batteries, even lithium ion batteries are moving it. All these batteries are working on based on this concept. So batteries are the best example for having chemical energy, electrical energy storage in the form of chemical. Obviously, when you go for nanoparticles, as I told you earlier, the behavior is something different from the bulk material. So for example, if I take the same amount of weight I can have huge amount of surface. So obviously I can store more amount of energy in a small weight. So definitely this nanoparticles development will reduce the weight of the device as well as the increase the performance of the device.
Good, sir. Thank you. Thank you for the explanation. Next, Rohit Kumar Singh Rathore from JNV, Bindpur, Madhya Pradesh. How electrochemical cells are going to solve India's energy crisis?
Energy crisis is something different. Okay, energy crisis is how to produce energy. So that cannot be solved by batteries. Okay. Batteries never produce any energy. What it can be, how it can contribute to the India's energy mission is the energy, the excess energy which you are producing. For example, the sunlight. We have too much of sunlight throughout the year. You can, if you have a solar panels, then easily you can convert into electrical energy. But the point is where to, how to use it for in the night time, since the sun is not available in the light in the night. In such a case, what you can do when you produce huge electricity during the daytime, it could be stored in your batteries. Then this nighttime application can be done by using this kind of batteries. So such a way, the batteries will really contribute, not only sunlight conversion, the windmills and hydropower, or wherever you have some excess energy in the daytime, or when you, for example, some of this energy will be excess in some season. So that can be also stored and then can be used for some application whenever you require. In such a way, it will really contribute to the India's energy mission.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you. Yes, sir. Good explanation. Next question is by Naveen Kumar by JNV Dukkabu. Can we generate light by injecting nanomaterials by plants?
Nanomaterials from plants?
Yeah. Can we generate the light by injecting nanomaterials?
Injecting nanomaterials to where? I'm not, I didn't get the questions properly.
From the plants. From, yeah.
No, from the plants, maybe you can generate some nanomaterials. For example, your materials has, your plants may have some kind of ions, okay, so that can be converted into nanoparticles. There are so many research people who are used plant extract as a reducing agent to make a nanoparticles, all these things. But from that you cannot produce any light, okay. So light can be produced when you have some kind of emission from by the particles. So unless otherwise, you cannot have any kind of light production by this kind of nanoparticles.
Okay, sir. Good. Thank you. Next, Bhavesh Shantar, please unmute and you ask your questions.
Yes, sir. So first of all, good evening, sir.
Yes. Proceed. Proceed.
Good evening.
So ask your question.
Yes, sir. So I want to ask that. So in between, you have told about that a battery which moves 200 kilometer per hour, or when we break to the machine, it is charged. So what is it? I do not understand that.
No. What I told you is when you use batteries, you can travel long distance. Okay. So for example, okay, if sir. Even there is some electric bike now in the market. Now you could see if you charge 100%, the manufacturer is promising us to you can travel up to 100 kilometers. If you charge one time 100%, then you can travel for 100 kilometers without further charging. The same thing is also the electric cars are in the market. For charge, it can give 300 to 400 kilometers. You can drive the vehicle. But unfortunately, due to the poor energy power density, you cannot go in high speed, as like your car which you are using in petrol or diesel car, you cannot go for high speed. The moment if you want to go for high speed, the power density will become high. So obviously some of the batteries will not help you to have high power density.
Okay. Yes, sir.
I don't know whether I have cleared your doubt.
Sir, you have also told about the ions which move from one place to another, and the electricity is generated, and when we use they move backwards. And so yes. And if there are total 100, so when they move backwards there are only 96 or 98. So why do not all are comes where some are left?
So this the 100 I just told you for just understanding, okay, but in reality there will be so many millions of ions. Okay,
yes.
That is one point. The other point is, yes, why I told you is, for example, there is a loss always, that's why your lithium ion batteries get fails. Why there is a loss? There are several mechanisms. I don't know how much you can able to understand, but the point is there are different kind of processing taking place. One is it may strongly bound on the anode materials. You may have some kind of defect in the graphite, or there may be some kind of dendrite formation. We call them as a dendrite formation. There is a metal formation on the surface of the anode materials. So there are so many other processes also taking place. Due to this, there may be some kind of loss in the lithium ions. So in each cycle, so that's why you were obviously maybe after maybe 1000 cycles or 1500 cycles, your battery will get totally fails.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir. And now says Pranavika. Please ask your questions. Kindly unmute and you can ask your question.
Yes, sir. I have a doubt. Like, you showed at last, you showed a bus. That time I thought like you showed like there were a electrical line, and when the bus gets charged low, then it gets the charge from there. So why can't we invent a bus? Like, there are many pollution if we use battery, electricity battery and all we can use, but most of in India they are not using that electricity. But why can't we use solar energy? It is like it don't gets over. We can use that instead of putting petrol and all, we can use that.
Yes, maybe a very interesting question. Yes, that is, you are right. Now, as I told you earlier, batteries are not producing any electricity. They are the device that store only electricity. The stored electricity, you can take it back whenever you need it. For producing electricity, you need either solar panels, or you may need some hydropower, or you may need some kind of windmills. Okay. So, but the problem is, how do I use this for practical application? For example, the bus you told in solar energy, you can also think about using it direct sunlight. But at the same time, if you assume that there was no sunlight for certain time, or if maybe the bus needs to go in the night time, how to do it?
Okay. Sir, that time can we can store that solar energy in the solar panel? Can't we store that?
Yes, solar panel cannot store electricity. It can produce only electricity. That electricity has to be stored in batteries. So the solar panels will not store the electricity. It will give you the electricity. At the same time, you need some other device that generally it is a batteries are used to store the electricity.
Okay, sir.
So even if you could see, there are so many street lights, it's powered by solar panels. So if you see the bottom of the street light, they may have small lead acid batteries. So the daytime it will produce, the solar panel produce electricity. That electricity will be stored in this your lead acid battery. When the night time, this energy, the energy from the lead acid battery comes to glow the your street light.
Okay, sir.
This will understand the your questions, I think. Pranivika is
yes,
clear.
Sir.
Yeah.
Yes. Sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank
and,
you, sir.
Anybody is ask nearby any questions? Please ask. Participants, if you need any questions, otherwise we have to move to be close to this session.
Sir, I want to ask that.
Yeah. Yeah,
sir,
please.
I want to ask if we can use batteries, why can't we use batteries in vehicles so that they can work easily and they don't need petrol or any electrical supplies?
Sorry, I didn't get your question. Can you please repeat?
I mean that if we add these types of batteries in a vehicle and let them run without petrol, diesel or anything else, can we make such a vehicle or any other?
Yeah,
item?
Yes. That's why the overall effort. Now that's why now we are working on to make some efficient and you know, there are batteries are at present very costly, particularly lithium ion batteries. Okay, when you want to go for electric vehicle, then the cost of the vehicle will be very high. So nobody, we cannot buy that electric vehicle. So that's why now people are working to reduce the cost of the batteries as well as the availability of batteries. Okay, so this is the next issues. So now slowly, maybe you can see after maybe 5-6 years later, most of our buses maybe, or at least the cars will be converted into electric cars.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you, Sagarika.
Can we get the recording of this meeting, sir?
I couldn't understand. What you ask?
Sir, can we get the recording of this meeting?
Within this week, we will get. Okay, I will send the details. The link, YouTube link, I will be sent through your teachers. You can get from the your teachers or principals the video recording. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, and please all the participants subscribe CSR Sikri YouTube channel and as well as the CSR Sikri. Sikyasa YouTube channel. It's a free of cost, so please subscribe. And future program, many events will be in the live mode only. So please subscribe all both channels. Okay.
Sir, please repeat your YouTube channel.
CSIR Sikri.
Okay,
Sikri.
Sir.
And another one is Sikyasa.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, both the channels you can subscribe. And you can get the many events in the future. Okay. Thank you for all the participants. Next week on 8th, we will meet in the some other program. Okay.
Sir, thank can you. I get the notification? Because
yeah, sure.
It came from my teacher.
Yeah, yeah. It will certainly will next week. All the notifications from your teachers only. Okay.
Okay, sir.
You can get the notifications from your teacher.
Okay,
thank you. Thank you for all the participants.
Okay,
I especially thank Dr. M. Sadish for your wonderful talk and as always the young minds to be nurturing their mind. And thank you all, cleared all the questions they are raised. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you once again for the jikyasa, particularly for the students who are listening to this talk. Thank you, one and all, for your valuable time.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.